Chancellery, the professors emeritus who are going to conduct this service, the leadership of the University of Pretoria, ladies and gentlemen, it is of course a sad day, but also a day of gratitude. I stand here also to join Professor De La Rey in giving thanks to the Almighty for the gift of Nelson Rolihlahla Mandela. We thank God for giving him the vision of seeing a South Africa, a non-racial South Africa, a democratic South Africa, a harmonious South Africa, long before that vision could be seen, could be observed by many of us. He saw that vision and God gave him wisdom, courage to work tirelessly towards his achievement. It is in recognition of this unique vision and this unique dedication, commitment, and adherence to principle that the whole world came to South Africa yesterday to celebrate and also give its gratitude to the Almighty and also use the occasion for reflection to say if it is possible in this era, when you read the scriptures, whatever your belief is, they always talk about prophets in the olden days where God could speak to a human being directly and give a vision and say, go out and undertake this project for me. But we are blind when it comes to seeing those prophets today, those people who are given those unique gifts and given the courage and wisdom and the integrity to actually work and achieve what to ordinary people may appear to be unattainable. It is for this reason that we are all assembled here today. I was privileged, of course, to grow up in a period when President Mandela was very active, a young man in his 40s, and during that time in the 60s, I had just reached my high school. I happened to go to Lovedale in the early 60s. At that time were his disciples. We worshipped everywhere that came from Madiba, came from all of the leadership of the African National Congress. And of course, being disciples, you follow your leaders and you become sometimes more enthusiastic than the leaders themselves. So like them, we ended up being the victims of the apartheid regime. I must say one of the highlights of that age of political activism was when in 1964, Mandela and his colleagues arrived in Robben Island. And I was a youngster then, 19 years old, to be able to see my leaders arriving in Robben Island. What really made us proud at that time was that when we were caught by the intelligence or by the forces of the apartheid system at that time, we used every trick possible to avoid going to jail, to avoid owning up that we're members of political organizations. But to have somebody standing in the door and saying, yes, I'm a leader of a liberation movement, And I've committed myself to work for the liberation of this country, for the demise of the apartheid system, and I will do whatever it takes, even if it means sacrificing my own life. We said we're grateful that he has, for once, articulated clearly what was behind the sacrifices that we're making. It was a great honor then, after we had gone our different directions, tried to live, to honor the principles, and to try to make whatever positive contributions we could make towards keeping the vision alive and making sure that young people don't give up. My role was in education. I decided that I had to focus on education, doing whatever I could to create positive conditions for young, talented people coming from disadvantaged communities to realize their potential so that they could actually be able to make a contribution in realizing President Mandela's vision. Post-1990, when he was released, I cannot describe how I felt when you are called and given a small assignment to actually contribute to the reconstruction of the country, to a post-apartheid democratic South Africa. The first call was when I was called to actually go and lead the Development Bank of Southern Africa and reposition it to be relevant to a post-apartheid South Africa. Later on, as some of you may be aware, I was privileged to be called upon to chair the first Council on Higher Education to talk about what is the new South Africa, the democratic South Africa, going to do with the higher education sector. Because primary education, yes, there was segregation, but to black people, the area where we felt very aggrieved was university level, where we had all these beautiful universities here. You would pass, you would work very hard and pass your matric and hope you'll be able to go, you'll be admitted to a university of your choice and be able to pursue studies in the area where your heart really, what really you wanted to do. But you couldn't do that at the time. So it was a great honor to be called upon to play a role in actually undertaking this task. It is really beyond description the feeling I have when I see universities like the University of Pretoria playing a leadership role in actually creating opportunities for learners, for young people coming from all backgrounds. African students from the Transkei, from the Eastern Cape, from Uganda, from all over the continent. That is a dream that we never thought would be realized in our lifetime. So I'm really delighted to hear the Vice President, the Vice Chancellor, talking with such passion about her vision of making sure that this university continues to build on the foundation laid by President Mandela in terms of continuing to extend opportunities for all peoples, especially people coming from disadvantaged background. Ladies and gentlemen, we should never forget that President Mandela, much as he is proud of his royal blood, I don't think people understand why people who are close to him call him Dalibunga. Dalibunga is not his name given to him by his parents. It's a name that you are given when you are a son of a chief. And I remember reading some of the books about his period in Robben Island, where he would address his letters as Dalibo. So a man like that, who comes from rural areas with that kind of pride in traditional African ways of doing things, having grown up, but taking the right lessons from that and becoming the proud person who cherishes his dignity as a human being, as Mandela did, and grow and become a leader of a democratic South Africa, a president of the country, and also a leader of humanity, as demonstrated yesterday. So my point is that opening opportunities and going out of our way as a university to really give support, search for young people coming from the most remote areas, identifying talent there and giving support, you will be doing humanity a great service. Because remember, Mandela came from such backgrounds. It is possible that there are many Mandelas. The challenges, of course, are not the political liberation of South Africa anymore now. That we face serious challenges in terms of inequality, in terms of employment, in terms of just the moral fiber of our country. So the need for leaders who are as inspired, energetic, and committed to visions as Mandela was, to take us forward. I'm very proud to be associated with the university, to hear the Vice Chancellor speaks the way that she has done this morning. I call on all of us to reflect on President Mandela's legacy and think very hard about what each and every one of us can do to make South Africa a better country. Ladies and gentlemen, we all know that there is corruption in the country. But that's not an excuse. We mustn't derive pleasure, you know, excessive pleasure from talking about actions and wayward behavior and conduct of others. We must focus more on what we as individuals can do. Mandela, I want just to end by saying, as if the gift, the vision of seeing this harmonious, non-racial South Africa that we could not see, working tirelessly to achieve it. Having achieved it, God was so kind to us that he again gave me a vision that, look, serve as president of the country, show the people of South Africa, show the people of the world how exactly leadership should be exercised, how leaders should carry themselves, what values, what priorities they have. Having done that, he had the vision to stand up as president of the country.